Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsup, and we are going to finish our discussion of the upper limb joints with the more distal major joints in this region. Again, recall that we discussed the joints of the hand, so those between the phalanges and the metacarpals, when we were talking about the osteology. So the focus of this video will be on the elbow joint and kind of a surprisingly complex region. The proximal radial ulnar joint, in addition to kind of talking through just radial ulnar joints in general, because there's more than just one. And lastly, we will finish with the wrist joint or the radiocarpal joint. All right. So what I think is really neat about the elbow joint, and we'll have something similar in the knee joint region as well, is that really there are going to be three separate joints in one joint capsule. So one articular capsule is going to surround three different joints. So you will have the humeral ulnar. So right here, this is humerus. This would be the ulna. This is what we typically think of when we think of the elbow joint. You'll also have the humeroradial, so where the head of the radius is going to articulate with the capitulum of the humerus. And then also, you're going to have the first or the most proximal of the radial ulnar joints, so that proximal radial ulnar joint. And we will kind of look through that region in a bit more detail later. But it's important to note that all three of these joints or all these articulations have a common joint capsule. All right, so when we think of the elbow joint, we're really thinking of that humeral ulnar joint. The humeroradial joint will play a small role in terms of some of these actions. But it's really that humeral ulnar that's playing the big role in terms of that hinge joint. And this is kind of the example of a hinge joint. You can very clearly flex. So if you say this is the arm, you can flex the elbow joint, so you can see kind of reducing the angle, and then extension would be increasing the angle, kind of going back towards anatomical position. So try flexing and extending your own elbow. You always think of like, I'm flexing and I'm kind of showing my muscles. You could show that biceps brachii when we're flexing the elbow joint, because that's one of the muscles that's contracting. Again, here, if you click on this link, there are videos of these different actions as well. Now we're getting into the first of these collateral ligaments, and we'll have these particularly in association with hinge joints. But what these will be are going to be ligaments that will be on either side, the medial or lateral side of a joint. So we'll have some collateral ligaments associated with the wrist region, with the knee region, and we have some of the elbow region. And the great thing about these are they tell you exactly where they are attaching. So that ulnar collateral ligament is going to be on the ulnar or the medial side, whereas the radial collateral ligament will be on the lateral side. It's really this ulnar collateral ligament that's one of the more stable of the ligaments. This radial collateral ligament is also going to have some of its fibers intertwine with this annular ligament that's surrounding the head of the radius. Both of these are considered capsular, which means that they appear as thickening of the capsule or the articular capsule. Now the articular capsule has been removed in the anterior and posterior portions, but if you add this back in, it would just like look like a thicker portion on either side. Okay, let's talk a little bit about the radial ulnar joints in general. And there will be three radial ulnar joints. We're going to spend the majority of our time talking about the proximal radial ulnar joint, which will be between the head of the radius and right here in terms of that radial notch of the ulna. So right here will be the proximal radial ulnar. This is going to be a pivot joint, and so it will allow that radial head to kind of rotate along or around the radial notch of the ulna. So we'll talk a little bit more about that action in a moment. But before we move away from this image, and here's another view of that proximal radial ulnar. But before we move away from the image, I want to talk about the other radial ulnar joints. You're going to have a very kind of similar one in the distalmost portion, the distal radial ulnar joint, which will be between, the head of the ulna and the little notch for the head, or the ulnar notch of the radius. So that will be the distal radial ulnar. This will also be a pivot joint. And then in the middle, connecting the two bodies or the shafts of the radius and the ulna, you will have another joint, which is the interosseous membrane. And we recall in our discussion of joint, the interosseous membrane is going to be a fibrous joint. So we're not a synovial joint in the area between the bodies of the radius and the ulna. So that syndesmosis type of joint, it will allow some movement, in particular kind of when you have the pivoting in these two regions, you do need a little bit of movement of the body. Because it's really, when we're talking about pivoting, and the bone that will be moving in these particular actions, it is all about the radius. It is the radius that will be doing the pivoting and the rotation. And so that movement that will occur with the proximal radial ulnar joint, and I have here with the distal radial ulnar, it will be what's called pronation or supination. And again, it's that radius that is the one that is going to be the moving bone. And so in supination, and this is key here, the radius and the ulna are going, so this is radius, this is the ulna, these are going to be parallel to one another. This is anatomical position. So palm is facing forward, the two bodies or the two shafts are parallel to one another, and so we are anatomical position. Whereas in pronation, you're going to have that radius rotating over the ulna, and this will be pronation. If you think of pronation, it's almost the opposite of anatomical position. So you have those palms facing posteriorly, or if your elbow is flexed, the palms would be facing inferiorly. Oop, I don't know what happened here. I apologize. But the annular ligament is going to be an associated ligament of the proximal radial ulnar joint. And as I had mentioned previously, it will completely encircle the radial head, so both anteriorly and posteriorly. And it really kind of helps to lock in that connection between the ulna. You do have that radial collateral ligament that will have its fibers kind of intertwine with the annular ligament. Now, there can be a dislocation of that radial head away from the capitulum and away from the radial notch of the ulna. And this is referred to as a subluxation or an incomplete dislocation, or you can have a complete dislocation. And this is more commonly referred to as a pulled elbow. And what will happen is that radial head typically will move distal to the annular ligament. Now, we're looking at a radiograph where this has occurred, and I want to note something here. You can see that we look like we have a completely separated epiphysis from the diaphysis with some growth still occurring here. So this is a growth plate right there. So you have a good indication that we're looking at a juvenile in this radiograph, which is not uncommon when you're talking about this type of injury. In fact, it is considerably more common for this to occur in juveniles. And the reasoning behind that is the annular ligament kind of gets to its larger size or its more adult-like sizes a little bit earlier or faster than the radial head does. So if you have a quick jerking of the forearm, that can cause that radius or the radial head to move inferiorly and kind of pop out, it'll make that noise, out of the annular ligament. And so generally you can kind of just place this back into its proper positioning without too much further damage. But if it does involve some type of movement or further distancing between the epiphysis and the diaphysis, that can have some issues as well. So that's why I always tell people, don't pick up your children by the hands and kind of swing them around. because you want to keep those radial heads nice and protected. Okay, last but not least, we're going to discuss the radiocarpal joint, which is more commonly referred to as the wrist joint. And so this will be formed by the distal end of the radius, which is going to be the dominant forearm bone. You will have an articular disc that is going to be located right about this region here. So between the ulna and the proximal row of carpal. So you do not have direct articulation of the ulna as part of the radiocarpal joint. That's why we say ulna plays a big role in terms of the elbow joint, little to no role in terms of the wrist joint, but you do have an articular disc right there. And then the proximal row of carpal bones will be what is forming the more distal portion of this joint. So all three of those bones will play a role. The fourth carpal of the proximal row, the pisiform, is kind of sitting right on top of the trichetrium, so it's not so much playing a role in terms of this joint. That's one of those sesamoid bones that is going to form in the flexor carpi ulnaris muscle. Now the wrist joint is an example of a condyloid joint. So you do have a considerable amount of movement that can occur here. So if we're looking at anatomical position right here, flexion would be kind of rotating up. So think about if you're flexing your wrist, those fingers would be trying to touch the anterior forearm, whereas extension, you would be moving back to anatomical position or kind of past that. Abduction and adduction. Abduction is going to be, again, moving away from the midline. Sometimes this is referred to as radial deviation. So abduction can sometimes be referred to as radial deviation, so deviating towards the radius, whereas adduction, heading or moving back towards the midline, is sometimes referred to as ulnar deviation. And again, I sound like a broken record here, but anytime that a joint can flex, extend, abduct, and adduct, that joint can circumduct as well. So try circumducting your wrist. You absolutely can make those circular movements there in that compound movement of these four. All right, excellent. We have made it to the end of the joints of the upper limb. And one quick review here. Because this action is a little unique, I want you to make sure that you understand what type of joint the proximal radial ulnar joint is. So what type of synovial joint is it? Is it a ball and socket? Is it a condyloid? Is it a hinge, a pivot, or a saddle? And if you need to pause the video, please feel free to do so. But when you are ready to go, let's work through the stem together. So we're trying to figure out which type of synovial joint is the proximal radial ulnar joint. Okay, so it's not a ball and socket joint. The ball and socket joints that we've talked about are really only the shoulder joint and the yet-to-be-discussed hip joint. So not ball and socket. It's not condyloid either. That is going to be that radial ulnar joint and some of the other joints, but not proximal radial ulnar. Not hinge joint, even though it is close to a hinge joint. So that humeral ulnar joint is a hinge joint, and it's going to be kind of encapsulated with that articular capsule, but it does have separate movements that are not hinge. Excuse me. Pivot, I might want to come back to this one. Saddle joint, not so much. Saddle's pretty similar to the condyloid joint. That's going to be between that first metacarpal and the trapezium of that distal row of the carpal bones. So pivot is going to be the correct answer. It will pivot, and by pivoting both the proximal and the distal radial ulnar joints, you can have the movement of pronation and supination that we discussed earlier. All right, excellent. Good job working your way through this question. I hope you're feeling more comfortable in these areas. And if not, you need some clarification on certain areas, always feel free to reach out to me with any questions. Thank you for your time and attention, and have a great day.